life beyond enlightenment. We continue to live a life followed by rituals, norms, conditionings. But life really is very simple. Very simple, as simple as you can never imagine. If you have to go somewhere and on the way there is a river, you have to cross the river to go to the other shore. What is the best way to do that? One way is you look at the depth of the water. If the river is shallow, you can walk through the river to reach the other shore. Maybe you may hold a stick to cross over to the other side of the shore. If the river is deep, you can swim. If the river bed is broad enough and swimming may not be possible or you do not know the swimming, then you can take a boat ride to reach to the other shore. But if you continue to sit down chanting your mantras, your scriptural injunctions, saying your prayers, can you reach to the other shore of the river? You may feel that something is happening, but certainly you will not reach to the other shore. You have to walk through the wade through the river bed in order to reach to the other shore. The life beyond enlightenment is as simple as that. The moment one becomes enlightened, it becomes so simple. No scriptural injunctions, simple talks. In 1989, when I started my radio program, that time it was called Hour of Introspection. The first program was a 15 minutes program. My wife said that you cannot speak properly, so you let someone else do the voice over. So a script was given to the person, and when the person, the female voice, a lively female voice, asked me, "Is this the spiritual program that I'm talking about?" The program began. Do we know how do we eat our food? The one of the most essential and basic act that each one of us has to do on a day-to-day basis. We have a platter full of delicious food in front of us. We have a morsel in our mouth. The next one is on our hand, and the eyes are constantly fixed on what is on the platter. 20 years after, she told me that I now realize this was the spiritual way of living. The day Buddha became enlightened, he became one with the entire cosmos. Simple things. When you come home from the work, you remember in the morning you put on your shirt, your jacket, your tie. All these was to give you a particular elegance, a particular way of presentation. When you return home, how do you treat these clothes, the outfit? Do we not take them out violently? Just throw here and there. The clothes that has given you an elegance, wearing those jackets, tie and shirt, you were considered as a soft gentleman, well-dressed. The shoes that give you protection, are you respectful to that? The food that is being prepared, that gives you nourishment, are you one with that food? No, we live our life unconsciously. When we simply take the vegetables, we handle them violently. The wares that cook our food, they have a kind of aliveness. The plants, the rivers, everything is pulsating with new life. When you are one with it, how can you be disrespectful to that? That is the one of the slogan of our cooking is cooking lovingly, cooking meditatively, cooking for Buddha. Many times in the class, the participant asks, which spice are you going to use? I said, the spice rack is in front of us. It is like I am in a place where a celebration is going on. Many people are looking at me, male and female. Whichever one gives me an invitation, I will dance with that person. No choice of my own. I am looking at the spice rack, and whichever the spice tells me, use me, I will add a new flavor to your food that you are cooking. I use that. It becomes very simple. You are holding a piece of apple or an orange in front of you, do you know this orange is nourished by the sun? In the light of the sun, when sun rises, appears on the horizon, the entire life comes into is as if that the world, everything that was sleeping in, all of a sudden awakes to a new life. And how do fruits grow and ripe? It is the energy of sun that makes it grow, and it is the energy of the moon that makes the fruit become sweet. It is the combination of the moon and the sun energy that makes the fruit mellow for our consumption. When someone dies, whatever way we do the cremation, Hindu way or Christian way, all the components of which the human body is composed of dissolve into its origin. Whether you are cremating it in a Muslim way or Christian way, the body is buried under the bed of earth, then it disappears. Where does the flesh disappears? The bones remain. When you are doing cremation Hindu way, the same thing happens. Everything dissolves and becomes part of the whole. This is what exactly happens when an individual attains to enlightenment. This is what happens when there is one attains to the state of fana, as Sufis call it. He is dissolving drop by drop in the vastness ocean of infinite river. It starts from its origin in the mountains or wherever it is, passes through a turbulent wave. Many times it swoops from its path, but its final destination is the ocean, the merger. When it comes very close to merging with the ocean, it is turbulent. It is going to lose its identity. It was known by a particular name. It has a particular taste, color and everything. But the moment the river drop merges into the ocean, it becomes oceanic. It is no more known by its previous name. It does not have the same taste as it has earlier on. Everything changes. Then it continues to live like oceanic. These are the simplest way. I recall I have heard from my mother and uncle Sufi Omkarnath, how did the grandsire Sheikh Brijmohan Lal live? These are not part of his scriptures. Every day is now we have the bed prepared in a particular place, but that time during summer the bed have to be prepared in an open space so that the breeze can come. During the winter season inside, so there is a bed which is woven with the cotton jute material, jute fiber, and during the day that bed is removed, in the night it is prepared. Every day the bed has to be prepared, and when he will sit down on the bed, he will say that this bed is not fixed properly, and he will get up, move left, right, or whichever way he feel, and then he sit down, now it is good. So my mother and her brother found that he was really fussy. Does he really know what he is saying, or he is simply hard to deal with? So one day when he had fixed his bed before sitting, they make a mark around the posts of the bed. Next day purposely they did not put the bed posts on the same spot. Bed was fixed. He came back, he sat down, and he said, bed is not fixed properly. He got up, moved the bed, and then he said, it was to utter dismay and surprise of my mother brother, that post came exactly on the same spots where it was the previous day. This is such a delicacy of a master that he lives. When he comes home, because it was a period which was dominated by combined effects of Islamic effects as well as British influence, he used to wear long a jacket reaching up to the knee and trousers, and he will put on a cap to go to his home. He will come home. There was a special places where his clothes were to be hanged, and especially the peg on which the walking stick was to be done. It has to be done in the same way. Shoes in the right place, the jacket. And if you do something differently, he will say, you disturb my way. It has to be done in the same way. Once it happened that his master, Sheikh Abdul Ghani Khan, was to go for pilgrimage. And according to the Muslim traditions, if he owes any money, he cannot go. So he told my grandmother that prepare a comforter and a mattress for the Sheikh, which he will carry with him while he is on his way for the pilgrimage. And a similar mattress and the comforter was made for my grandfather. It was new. His comforter and mattress he had used once. When the Sheikh came, he requested that the new mattress and the comforter be made available for the Sheikh. It happened that the servant who did arrange for the bed, by mistake he used the mattress and the comforter of the Sheikh Brij Mohan Lal, not the new one. He sat down on this and very loudly in a voice called Bade Mia. He used to call Bade means big, Mia is a matter of respect, the big gentleman. Just as sometimes when we say to our children or the people around, this bed is yours. Very humbly he said, Hazrat, this was made specifically for you. He looked at him askance. He said, Mia, should I listen to you or to the bed? The bed says that it is yours. The bed says, the comforter and the mattress says it is yours. And you tell me to believe that it is new? Go and inquire. When he went inside and inquired, it was his mattress and the comforter was arranged for the Sheikh. Such a delicacy of consciousness. What is that he was preserving at that moment? It is the consciousness that reflects through every act and behavior of your life. This is the living life beyond enlightenment. No, there is no scripture in it. No scriptural injunction, he said. Simple act. When Sheikh Brij Mohan Lal slept on that bed, he is soaking in a particular consciousness which is undivided and flinching. And whatsoever comes in contact with that, animate, inanimate, they absorb the vibrations of that. The place becomes alive. And then if you are sensitive, if you are sensitive to perfumes, you will know that this particular perfume is of this make. You do not need to see the bottle that which perfume did your wife or spouse or someone has put on. You know, because you are familiar with the perfumes. Awareness, tawajjuh, is a perfume of the eternal garden. And with that you will know this is the tawajjuh of Hazrat Sheikh Mujaddid Alif Sani رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ اور Hazrat Shah Bahauddin Naqshband رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ اور Hazrat Jalaluddin Rumi رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ or for that matter belongs to which one. Just as each perfume and fragrance has its aura, has its fragrance, so too each master is there. No one has explained this as beautifully in a simple word than a 12th century Zen master, and in 10 short poems he explains the entire journey of life beyond. It is called a story of 10 bulls. The first bull represents the energy, the search for the bull. In the pastures of this world, I endlessly push aside the tall grass in search of the bull. The bull is lost amidst the wilderness in the duality that surrounds us. I endlessly push aside the tall grass, the duality, the conflict, the scriptural injunctions. All these create a conditioning and barriers. And what am I searching amidst that? The bull. Following unnamed rivers, lost upon the interpreting paths of distant mountain, my strength failing and my vitality exhausted, I cannot find the bull. I only hear the locust chirping through the forest at night. The bull, the energy, the consciousness is lost. What need is there to search? Only because of separation from my nature, I fail to find him. In the confusion of senses, I lose even his track. Far from home, I see many crossroads, but which way is the right way, I know not. Greed and fear, good and bad, all these dualities entangle me in many ways. Now, walking along the path, suddenly he discovers the footprints. Along the river bank, under the trees, I discover footprints. Even under the fragrant grass, I see his prints. Deep in remote mountains, they are found. These traces no more can be hidden than one's nose looking heavenward. Understanding the teaching, I see the footprints of the Buddha. Then I learn that just as many utensils are made from one metal. Then I learn that just as many utensils are made from one metal, so too are myriad entities made of the fabric of self. Unless I discriminate, how will I perceive the true from the untrue? Not yet having entered the gate, nevertheless I have discerned the path. The journey continues along the path. Now you begin to perceive the Buddha. I hear the songs of the nightingale. Sun is warm, the wind is mild. Willows are green along the shore. Here no bull can hide. What artist can draw that massive head, those majestic horns? When one hears the voice, one can sense its source. As soon as the sixth sense emerges, the gate is entered. Whenever one enters, one sees the head of the Buddha. This entity is like salt in the water, like color in the dye stuff. The slightest thing is not separate from the self. The slightest thing that we see is composed of the same stuff as you are, Mira. You are also being nourished by the dew drops, the clouds that are filled with water. They nourish you, the sun, the moon, Mother Earth, all these nourish you. Now he is catching the Buddha. I seize him with a terrific struggle. His great will and power are inexhaustible. He charges to the high plateau, far above the cloud mists, or in an impenetrable ravine he stands. He dwelt in the forest for a long time, but I caught him today. Infatuation for scenery interferes with his direction. Infatuation for the scenery interferes with his direction. Longing for sweeter grass, he wanders away. His mind is still, is stubborn and unbridled. If I wish him to submit, I must raise my will, so that I can be on top. Now, taming the whip. The whip and rope are necessary. These are determination that I take, a resolute determination. These are the whip and rope that are necessary. Else he might stray off down some dusty road. Being well trained, he becomes naturally gentle. Then unfettered, he obeys his master. The energy is being dead. When one thought arises, another thought follows. When the first thought springs from enlightenment, all subsequent thoughts are true. When the first thought springs forth from that state of enlightenment where you are one with the entire cosmos, the plants, the rivers, the mountains, we are made up of the same stuff. All subsequent thoughts are true. Through delusion, one makes everything untrue. Delusion is not caused by objectivity. It is the result of subjectivity. What is the nature of your subjectivity? Has it experienced oneness all around? Oneness of all paths, oneness of all beings, sentient and insentient? Then delusion is not caused by objectivity you live. It is the result of subjectivity. Hold the nose ring tight and do not allow even a doubt to settle in you. Riding the bull home, he has tamed the bull now. Mounting the bull, slowly I returned homeward. The voice of my flute intones through the evening. The voice of my flute intones through the evening. Measuring with hand beats the pulsating harmony, I direct the endless rhythm. Whosoever hears this melody will join me. I extend no magic. The words, when they are spoken, they create a gap. It creates a musical symphony. This struggle is over. Gain and loss are assimilated. I sing the song of the village woodsmen and play the tunes of children, embodiment of innocence. Astride the wool, I observe the clouds ever. Onwards I go, no matter who may wish to call me back. The bull transcended. Astride the bull I reach home. I am serene. The bull too can rest. The dawn has come. The dawn of new awakening. In blissful repose, within my thatched dwelling, I have abandoned the whip and the rope. All is one law, not two. There is only one law. We only make the bull a temporary subject. It is as the relation of rabbit and trap, of fish and net. It is as gold and frost, or moon emerging from a cloud. One path of clear light travels on throughout endless time. One path of clear light travels on throughout endless time. Both bull and self transcended. Whip, rope, person and bull all merge in looping. They dissolve into oneness. This heaven is so vast, no message can sustain it. How may a snowflake exist in a raging fire? Here are the footprints of the patriarchs, the masters. You can see. The saints follow the saintly path. Ya ilahi ta'abad kaim rahe silsila. This path of awakening may continue till eternity lasts. Mediocrity is gone. Mind is clear of limitations. I seek no state of enlightenment. Neither do I remain where no enlightenment exists. Since I linger in neither condition, eyes cannot see me. If hundreds of birds strew my path with flowers, such praise would be meaningless. If hundreds of birds strew my path with flowers, such praise would be meaningless. I appreciate your messages, the messages that have poured in, but these strew my path. All that comes along the path are meaningless. Reaching the soul. Too many steps have been taken returning to the root and the source. Better to have been blind and deaf from the beginning. Dwelling in one's true abode, unconcerned with that without, the river flows tranquilly on and the flowers are red. Dwelling in one's true abode, unconcerned with that without, all that is outside you are not bothered. River flows tranquilly on and the flowers are red. From the beginning, truth is clear. Poised in silence, I observe the forms of integration and disintegration. One who is not attached to form need not be reformed. The water is emerald, the mountain is indigo, and I see that which is creating and that which is destroying. The dissolution and creation are one. From one side there is dissolution, from the other side there is creation. Now the last one comes in the world. Barefooted, naked of breast, I mingle with the people of the world. My clothes are ragged and dust laden. and I am ever blissful. I use no magic to extend my life. Now before me, the trees become alive. This is the state of living beyond enlightenment. The master does no magic, extends no magic, but whosoever comes within that energy field gets transformed, or cannot remain without being influenced by the energy. The sun is catalyst, so is a master. He remains a catalyst. He does not do anything. Sun is so far away, but in the presence of sun acting as catalyst, something begins to happen to the flowers, the fruits, and the entire cosmos, and there is a different kind of a glow. Master is an energy field. His presence acts as catalyst, and in that presence, if you are vulnerable, if you are open to that energy field, transformation will begin to happen, even if he does not say anything. My clothes are ragged and dust laden, and I am ever blissful. I use no magic to extend my life. Now before me, the trees become alive. Even all that was not pulsating with new life becomes alive. Inside my gate, 1,000 sages do not know me. The beauty of my garden is invisible. Why should one search for the footprints of the patriarch? I go to the marketplace with my wine bottle and return home with my staff. I visit the wine shops and the market, and everyone I look upon becomes enlightened. I extend no magic. Simply my presence that I am, it creates an insatiable quest. I become your insatiable quest. In that, an intense quest arises. How can I attain to this state of awareness? That is the way the flowers blossom. Each one of you is a flower of this Garden of Eden that has to blossom to spread its beauty and fragrance. And I will see that it happens. Whatever is written, that you have to attain to this much level of awareness, you will certainly attain to that, but journey must continue. Since day before yesterday, I was remembering that there is something different around the corner. I was remembering what had happened on 12th of May, but this day was reminding me again and again. Then yesterday morning I remembered, yes, it was 12th of May 1972 when this transformation happened. As a result, I decided, although in the preparation of that I was speaking of the enlightenment, the life beyond death, how one should enter into death. And also it was after when Hazrat Sheikh Nazim Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unhu left this world, it was incumbent on me to speak on that master and through him share my insights into life and life beyond. Then this particular session was arranged.